Feeling the beer already, eh?
Hey!
Welcome to the Groovin Witta Classics Räppiklassikot Vol. 3. This time in video, because we have a human tripod.
Yes.
We're going through 1988, Public Enemy. We are not gonna break down the album as whole, because everybody knows this is the most important rap record ever. So we're gonna go through our own experiences with the album.
Exactly, Mundo. And listen to the album while we talk.
So get your album, get your beer, your coffee, your pee, caps and t-shirts, and get ready.
Cause it's time for Public Enemy number one.
One.
All right, homeboys.
Let's take a seat there. So I think we're gonna be starting with a good one, with the Bring the Noise immediately.
Yeah, well, I have to say that about this intro, this actually was recorded in London,
yeah,
and they had a live show over there, and it was hosted some London DJ.
Yeah.
And after that, Professor Griffin brings out the Armageddon, and immediately you know that something is happening, because if you listen to this album compared to the Yo Bummer's The Show, it's 10,000 more volts to the sound. I mean, it's
bass.
Yeah.
This is like one of the rap songs that even our friends who don't rap, they know the lyrics of this song, because all the heavy metal fans listen to Public Enemy, where we grew up with Real.
Yeah.
Like that. This was the only rap band in late 80s and early 90s that you wouldn't get your head kicked in if you had the shirt on or something like that. So it was the different times.
And by the way, guys, did you hear Nations first, or did you hear Yo Bummer's The Show first, the album?
I think I heard this one first.
Yeah,
me too.
Because when I heard Yo Bummer's The Show, I think it was several months later that I heard this record. I was like, oh, well, it's good, but it's really mellow. You know? But if I heard Yo Bummer's The Show first, I think it would be a romance record better, actually. Mm.
Hey, wasn't there a metal version of Bring the Noise?
Yeah, with Anthrax.
Yeah.
It's on, I think that, what the hell was the third album? Fourth album. Apocalypse, 91.
No. Is it here?
Which one is it?
I think it's here, man.
Well, whatever.
I think it's a CD extra. Because not on, all the songs were printed on the vinyl. But do you...
No, actually, you was right, Kelly, actually. Yeah, yeah, it's on a...
Surprise, surprise, Kelly was right.
No, yeah, well, you know. But it's on this, this was actually 92 or something like that. 92.
Yeah.
Yeah, anyways.
After that album, I saw Public Enemy the first time live in Finland at Province Rock. So, kick-ass show.
Do you have some memories of the show? How was it?
Yeah, it was like everything advertised, like you had S1W going on, but it was like midsummer, so the lighting effects weren't that great when the sun was shining. But yeah, it was still a good show, and I think we all went to see them at Vanha.
Yes.
In the 90s.
Yeah, in the city center. Did they have a band that was touring with them?
No, I
don't. No.
I'm not sure. Was I in the Swan Hockey?
Yeah, but we were.
Yeah,
we were.
Anyway, I saw Public Enemy with Prodigy actually in Dublin. They had a
show
together, and Keith was alive back then as well.
Yeah, and we saw Public Enemy Radio last day.
Yeah, true.
And actually, it was the best from Wu-Tang, De La Soul, and Public Enemy.
Yeah,
Public
all
Enemy. This was just on Public Enemy Radio. I
remember in Dublin when Public Enemy started the show, Flavor Flav came on came on stage with this hover, you know, this
hoverboard,
yeah, just rolling across the stage, and I was wondering when will he fall down or something, because it looked pretty dangerous.
We digress. Let's talk more about the album itself. That was Bring the Noise, by the way. Sorry, if you're into listening to this, check the description below.
Don't believe the hype.
Because we are not gonna play every song, it's gonna be in the background. But that record, can you guess real, how much did it cost to record the album?
Could it be something like $100,000?
$25,000. Everything was mixed manually.
Okay.
And it was pre-produced so well, so they just like recorded vocals and stuff like that. Hey. Bomb Squad.
Yeah.
Bomb Squad. Is
do you happen to know, are the old samples cleared?
No, they are not. Because the Bismarck case came after this album.
Okay.
So if those who don't know Bismarck case, that's when after that it came mandatory to pay for the samples. Except if you see it.
Yeah. I think now that
our albums are mixtapes. Yeah.
Don't believe the hype.
Yeah. But nowadays it would be quite impossible to make this type of record anymore. Yeah. Because there's so many samples in it. Nobody has that money to clear it anymore. So. It's a good time.
Yeah.
Good times of sampling.
But also the Bomb Squad producing techniques involved a lot of sampling. I know that in some of the songs there might be 10 samples on top of each other. And a lot of these snippets out of other songs, like jazz records, rare records. So I don't believe that they don't even remember all the samples they put in.
Yeah.
But talking about Don't Believe the Hype, this is one of my favorite songs on the album, definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I remember going to school on the, was it 7th grade or so, that all the metalheads were also listening to Don't Believe the Hype.
Yeah.
And I remember talking about that, what this hype is actually.
Yeah.
We
didn't know.
We didn't know.
8th grade or something like
yeah.
that.
Yeah.
What the fuck? And it has a lyric sheet.
Yeah. But this is pre-internet, so you cannot check this out from Wikipedia.
So guys, what did you think hype was?
I thought it was a guy.
That's a sketchy guy.
Yeah. Yeah. He sees the video and realizes why Public Enemy never called.
Yeah.
Don't believe the hype.
But really, another question I asked the guys before you came in. Up until 2010, how much do you think the album sold?
Yeah, if the production cost were 25,000, so
no, it was recording cost.
Ah, recording. So, but I think could it be double platinum?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
We have the knowledge.
But
we
were discussing like prior that we thought it would be more, like 4 or 5 million, because that album is still on top 100 albums ever.
Yeah, yeah.
Not rap.
Yeah, but it's classic. Yeah. It's not
so
like a commercial success as that, but it sold more than CNN.
But you know what? In 2013, Public Enemy became a Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, so that's a big thing, I think, for the rap music. So, and all because of this album, I think, because that's the main.
Yeah, I think the first four albums, first three are legends. The fourth one was when I kind of shifted away from Public Enemy. It had good songs, but the first three are so good that we listened to so many times. So god, how many times those albums? And actually, Public Enemy t-shirts were maybe the only bootleg t-shirts that you could get from Shop Tetuan. No other rap shirts except Public Enemy were available, like 88, 89.
And do you remember what the t-shirt said?
No.
it had a Public Enemy on it, and it said, "Fear of a Black World."
That t-shirt could be taken differently nowadays.
Because it didn't copy this directly. It didn't say it was a Public Enemy.
But it was interesting how big album it was like in the 80s in Finland. Yeah. Because I went to buy the album and it was in the window display. 88 in Finland. I was like, what the actual fuck? Because nobody listened to rap. There's like Run DMC, Raising Hell, and that's it.
Yeah.
And also, this is actually something that I read about, that some critics says that
no more music shall suffer.
Yeah. Because after Public Enemy was so big success with this album, they had this message that they want to bring out. Somebody says that they drifted away from the hip-hop rap genre and it wasn't anymore in that, but I think that's bullshit, because if you listen to it, yeah, that's purest hip-hop in that form.
But for us, because that came out, Apocalypse 91 came out 92, did you say? They started to criticize the drinking, so that's why we was kind of...
So now we're listening Cold Lamping with Flavor.
Yeah.
So Flavor Flav is a MC and character in Public Enemy that somehow makes the band somehow.
Yeah.
Because that
the basic
message is very militant.
Yeah. You have to have the lighter side.
Yeah.
Because think about it, if it's only Chuck D and Brief and it would be quite militant actually. You need the Flav to have Joker in it.
Yeah. But it was kind of funny, like that. This one of the reasons why people got away with a lot of things prior internet was like when they did the anti-crack song, Flavor Flav was calling crack.
Yeah.
The bass hit.
Yeah. Right before the video shoot. So that kind of like
911 is a joke.
No.
It's a living
bass. Night of the Living Bass.
Ah, okay. Yeah.
In that video, he's actually toasted.
Okay.
No internet, no cameras on the phone, so light your pipe.
But I guess the rest of the band was
pretty like
straight.
Yeah. Except Griff might have had issues with the Jews, but.
Yeah, they had this beef with third bass, because third bass was a Def Jam artist as well.
Yeah.
And I remember this beef. I think it was in Ilta-Sanomat in Finland about that he made this anti-Semitistic comment on some news.
MC Search took it to himself. Because
and there was a big beef with them. And, but what is your actually top one song in the album?
I like She Watched Channel Zero because of the Slayer sample. It was easy to sample because both were on Def Jam at the time. I think that is my favorite one. At the moment, I had multiple favorites like Don't Believe the Hype and Black Steel Now of Chaos. But at the moment, I like She Watched Channel Zero.
What about Rio?
I think from the very early on, I really like this next song, Terminator X to the Edge of Panic. Because
the DJ song.
Yeah, the DJ song somehow, because I was wondering that how do the DJs do their stuff? Because I didn't know. And I didn't know about the production techniques. My name is MC Real because I started to make songs taping from reel to reel. And this has like tens of reels on top of each other, so we didn't know much about sampling. And this DJ stuff where you're working on two turntables. Later I knew what the records were that the Terminator X played. And I think he's doing a great job.
So your answer is the terrorist.
So you like the DJ song?
Yeah.
Terminator X.
So let's listen to it.
I think I like the Rebel, but you don't.
Yeah. Kiadi said before we started recording that Rebel is not a favorite song, but I think Rebel is is definitely one
it
of
the top
songs. It
has the same sample all the time, like the Swedish
song. Terminator X to the edge of panic.
One, yeah. Two, three.
Do you know where the sample is? That
Queen.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Yeah. It's actually the Flash Gordon song.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I remember that DJ Jukka, when we started to make rap together, he bought the turntables and all this stuff, and he had a couple of singles from this album. To bring the noise and something like that, and we used to rap on it, and we had our first rap gigs actually in school over these records, and it was cool. But I remember one gig where it was, I think the Terror Dome came 89, 88 or 89, the first single.
Yeah, the
single. Yeah. We had a show that in the school, and there was these two guys, Joni and Jarno, were dancing, our break dancers, and Jukka was on the stage with the record player, and I needed to come from behind, and Jukka started the and I should have started rapping on the first beat over there. When I stepped to the stage, we all was really nervous, and Jukka started playing, so it was I was like, oh shit, what the fuck is happening here? So that was our first gigs that we did.
So the first side A after Terminator X's song was Mind Terrorist.
That's actually okay songs, but they are not like the hits. Those are not the hits we are looking for.
Louder Than a Bomb and Caught Can We Get the Witness.
But everybody knows the story, I hope, about the about their album.
Yeah.
What were you saying real about that?
Tuossa kuvaa sen flippauksen.
DJ Jukka. But okay. But I actually kind of understand that this might be the A side. Now you think of it.
So the story was that this should have been the first side. But after the mixing, they decided to do it the other way around. Do we have a skipping deal? But yeah.
So the B is A and A is B. So it's like ABBA.
Okay. James broke the record.
Ooh.
This is how you do a hard rock, not fucking hard rock, heavy metal rap song. Not those. I hated those Run DMC hard rock songs.
But what's the band? What's
but
the band?
You know, actually, did you use similar guitar sample on CNF? Song 11.
Got this one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was thrash metal also.
Yeah, because it's quite familiar actually.
Yeah.
If you check it out, it's
It's not the same band.
The influences are all around.
Yeah.
And what's the band? Is it Anthrax?
No, it's Slayer.
Slayer, okay.
Because they both were in Def Jam.
Yeah.
Because the Rick Rubin knows his stuff, or knew his stuff.
Was there other metal bands in Def Jam?
I think later on they had what the hell is it? Dancing.
Ah,
from there.
And then they somehow split the Def Jam.
Yeah, it's Def American.
Yeah.
But then he gave us the Geto Boys, which was mixed version from the Groovin from on the other level.
Yeah.
Which is one of my favorite albums. Look it up. But on YouTube, there's a wrong version. There's a version of that it doesn't have the Joker sample in that one song, Gangsta of Love, or what was it? It's really hard. But we are digressing again, but hey, it's this and it's CNN, so you know this is gonna happen.
We are talking about life.
Yeah. If you just skip, we are talking about this, because you couldn't change the channel because this is YouTube.
Yeah.
Or if you could, mesmerizing. But yeah, on this side I think we have really strong, like, this might actually be better side.
Yeah.
In my opinion.
And I think it's a good idea to put this side to last, because then the listener thinks that, hey, the quality is not dropping, it's increasing. Yeah. Okay.
And they have the Prophet's Rage here, which is now the Jack the Unbeat Reels project band name.
Somebody has scratched it, album, I think, so. Is it DJ Kane?
In my case,
has this been in DJ Kane's position? Because
Kane, where are you now?
Give us that. Yeah, you can start the skit, let's just skip it to the next.
Hey, there's a lot of also speech samples on the album.
Yeah.
Do you remember
Elijah Muhammad and
Malcolm X?
Yeah. It's like, but I think this started also like Public Enemy. We listened to a lot of like Poor Righteous Peaches, Paris. And we listen to really
similar,
but even more harder.
Yeah,
like they didn't have the Joker in the band. It was undiluted.
Yeah,
straight message.
So think about it. That kind of movement happened in the United States in the 80s, and it resonated kids in Helsinki and Vantaa areas.
And this was all before Google, social media, YouTube, or something. So It's amazing.
Right? Yeah, in the early 90s, we started to have the rap magazines in Finland, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Rap pages and Word Up, stuff like that.
Yeah.
But,
you know, this video actually, I have it on VHS back in the day, and I used to watch this, I mean, daily.
Yeah.
So it was quite worn out. And it's an interesting video, really, the concept video, because they're splitting it and making it a different type of.
Text here, subtitles.
Yeah,
subtitles.
So watch the video if you can. It's on YouTube, definitely.
Yeah, yeah. We had also Boogie Down Productions, the 1990 video was also great. Those are both on VHS.
And Ice-T's.
Ice-T's.
Yeah. Steal this VHS.
And you should check out Facebook page, because we are at the moment going through top 5 MCs of our, and we are going to go through also bands and stuff like that. So I believe we are gonna have some main band future up there.
Okay, right now, before this is published, we are on number 3. And I can say right now, my number 2 is Chuck D. So Chuck D is really something that influenced me a lot back in the day. So, of course, the man. Yeah.
And there's how Public Enemy came about was that Chuck D was a radio DJ. And he played music from the early New York bands and artists. And even those kids who were looking up for Chuck D was his DJ name, and he was the older cat in the business. But then he also got into rap, and then they produced the songs that came from Russia Show. So Chuck D was the older cat already then.
But I think he was over 30.
But he's still touring. It's like CNF, we never stop.
Never stop.
Yeah. And I remember when I read the Run DMC book, and it was DMC that first got heard the Yoban was the show album, and he was like, our career is done, because this is so good.
Yeah.
I mean, he was totally devastated that this is so good sound, that Run DMC is so fast now.
This is what I miss about vinyls. The lyric sheet. Mm. Like, I was in the 8th grade when this came out, and I learned shit.
Yeah.
Message!
Yeah. And Public Enemies is always about the message.
Yeah.
So,
maybe like, we don't need lyric sheet on 2 like through album, but
yeah.
I think we
not show home. I got the message, you know, man.
Yeah.
I'm with you on that one.
But you know, actually, yesterday I watched this YouTube video about Ad Rock from Beastie Boys, that he was on a radio show, and he was something like, he's so old school, over 40, and he can't really understand this thing that
nowadays that the musicians don't make their own music or their own lyrics, or rappers are using
all the covers, lyrics, the album.
All the covers in the album. So it's something that he can understand, and I can resonate to that. You know, if you have a band, you do it yourself, you have the production, you have the MCs, you have the concept, and you do the fucking covers all the time. But nowadays, it's, you lend lyrics from some writer and you have just voice on the record, so...
You buy the beats.
Yeah, you know, it's... you can feel it, it's not real, you know?
Yeah.
But he said also that he doesn't listen to music, like, new music at all.
Yeah.
I saw the same interview. But it's a good start of the lines. I got a letter from the government the other day. All of us here are Finnish males. We all had a letter from the government.
Go to war.
No. Military service.
Military.
Not go to jail. But okay. Yeah, this has had a really good video. This song also.
Okay.
What was it?
It's like? he escapes from the jail.
Okay.
Because all in the lyrics it's like what who what bazooka was who, it was my rescue, it was the S1W or something like that.
Yeah.
So it's like
come closer, let's talk about the cover of the album.
Yeah, but you know what is missing on the album? Did you know this actually? There's no explicit concept stamp on this album because it actually came after this, because it came when I think NWA or something like it was
too
like
true.
But is there curse words here?
It's so deep. Yeah, there's a couple fucks I think, but not too many.
I'm not sure that there is any.
Yeah.
But there's always here. A statement at the bottom. Freedom is a road seldom traveled by the multitude.
I really didn't get it when I was young.
Yeah.
Sounded very, very...
I think the strange album cover, this is now, I think, I'm not sure, but I think it's taken by Glenn Friedman, who has done all of the legendary album covers in the 80s, 90s, and shots about rappers.
And if you think about logos, the brands, what's the
better
brand than this? I mean, forget about it, that's the best.
And is it these guys who they are targeting? Run DMC, look at the cap. I think it's them.
Yeah.
On the logo.
No, I read somewhere what the meaning was, I have forgotten.
I think that they are aiming DMCs with the content. And then they used Run on DMC's picture. Uh-huh. The logo.
Yeah. I didn't know that.
Yeah. Then they have Chai Martins.
They wanted to be.
Oh, okay.
They have Def Jam hoodies on and everything, but never materialized.
Okay.
And if you ask Beastie Boys, did they like to be a Def Jam artist, that's a whole nother story.
But, yeah.
But how many albums actually Public Enemy did for the Def Jam? Because
was four.
Yeah,
I
Black
think
that is.
Yeah.
Yeah, and also this one is. But after that, is it?
No idea what was.
We need to Google it.
Yeah, we're just doing it on the spot because we have video camera material and beer. So
and black coffee.
We are doing this the old-fashioned style when we didn't have Google.
Yeah.
Nowadays, everybody asks a question. Wait a minute, I got the answer. But back in the day when we had home parties and so on, we just drank beer and we thought
and people
about,
knew stuff.
Yeah, people knew stuff. That was the difference.
What's the
last CNN? Put your question down there and let's communicate.
We will Google it. We don't know jack shit anymore.
So if you know more about the album, put your comments down.
Yeah.
And
what's your favorite song?
Yeah.
Put that there.
Exactly.
Yeah, I think James, put on your favorite song now.
The Rebel. We will build a rebel.
Because we are talking enough shit about.
Yeah, but was it the
this record?
Was the sample that Madonna used to sample? Was it before the rebel?
Oh yeah, it was after it.
I think it's the next song.
Yeah. Because we can listen that because it was quite amusing back in the day when a Public Enemy actually sued Madonna for sampling their song that has been sampled from James Brown, so it was something.
It was exactly
the same. So.
I remember I was really pissed about the fact because that wasn't like a common thing then. Now it's common that people just take somebody's beat and make a new song and it becomes a hit. But back in the days it was like sacrilegious. Like, fuck the bitch. God damn.
You don't touch her. No. And I think it's the next song that is coming out.
Do you remember what was the song Madonna did?
It was this... when you hear it. It was... Yeah.
James can show you the dance moves, so you know.
No, but she was fucking all the time on the videos, something like that.
Yeah, because it was there was an exhibition.
Madonna, quit it!
And also a photo book from Madonna called Sex.
Yeah.
He was dating Warren Beatty at the time.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. And it was this kind of very raunchy video.
Yeah, it was great. And actually the song was pretty much this. It wasn't,
wasn't
too much singing or anything like that.
And
just
funny, it was produced by some guy.
Yeah.
What did you do? I was playing.
Maybe she should have contacted Bomb Squad.
But actually, we have sampled this also.
Oh no. But that's okay. But that's okay.
I think our early cassettes.
Yeah, we have this on tapes.
Yeah.
It was MC Hill or something like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, it was.
It was the instrumental, yeah.
The third MC of the early.
Well, really the song where he sampled that and then just like, what was it? Was it Graham Hill?
Yeah, Graham Hill.
Formula One driver, we found some fucking vinyl about him telling about some race.
Yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Alright, this is James. James, number one.
Wow.
I like this. I mean, you said that the squeaking sound is too much, but I think it's the essence.
I think it's the Public Enemy sound.
Yeah, that's what
but
it is. It's the noise.
Yeah. Do you remember what sample is it?
They have used it two times actually on this album.
I searched
because I wanted to know what the sample was, but now I've forgotten. I think it might be James Brown.
Yeah, or Coltrane or something. Well, if you know it, put it down there.
Justify my love.
Justify
my love. Oh, yeah.
That's it.
I Google it.
Yeah.
The voice behind the camera is the manager / security.
Yeah.
But one thing we were discussing right before we start filming that, at least for me, I listened to this album so goddamn much. I think the only album I listened more was when I was 10 years old and I had Kiss Alive 2 and I wore the tape the fucking out, it broke in my Walkman. But this is second.
Yeah.
Like I listened to it prior to this taping one time through and I had to skip a couple of songs because they are permanently here. So I don't need the reminder how good the album is. It's very important.
I think I've worn out immediately the Eric B. Break and Follow the Leader album. Because when I bought it from the street beat, I think I listened it 10 times or more at once. And I never actually listened this album so much. So it's.
Yeah. I listened to it a lot, like KOD. I remember us going outside with the boombox. Listen to Eric B. Follow the Leader and this album.
And Strictly Whispers.
Yeah. All the time.
Yeah.
But we are moving to the end of the album. I would like to discuss that. What is the influence of this album to you?
For us, it's obvious about the production technique. For first Real, who made the beats when we started, and now me, who make most of the beats now for CMF. It's like you can take whatever. They take whatever speeches, like odd sounds, compress it to the dope ass beat. So that's one. And for me, it was like interesting to see that a message can be dope. Like, you don't have to be preachy. You can have a dope song and that leaves you guessing like, oh fuck yeah, that is bad. Like, crack is bad, eh? But yeah.
For me, this is one of the, or even might be the most essential rap album for me, because this somehow made me to love hip hop and also to become an MC. And somehow, like Kelly said, the production value is great, the message is there, but they are actually songs there. They are not like
just
beats and you rap over it. There's in each song there's an idea, and somehow we're talking that Chuck D was older than the other MCs at the time, but even though they were like in their early 20s, they created this album, and it's still a classic, and it's still an important record, and that's what we always want to do in CNF as well, make music that has a meaning and value, and I think this whole album is for me it's the best Public Enemy album.
Yeah,
definitely.
Exactly.
But it's also one of the best rap and hip hop albums ever.
And best albums.
Yeah.
That's why we didn't go like the basic rappy classic of the group. Because everybody knows the
song.
But James, your thoughts?
Well, I think so. Also, I agree with both of you guys that this was the first real concept album that you really want to listen from beginning to the end, because you want to see where the story goes.
Yeah.
I mean, it's not just songs. It's really the whole album is something that has something in it. And same here, because when I first heard it, I was totally, rap is my game. Forget everything else, I wanna do lyrics, I wanna be a rapper. And you know, back in the day when we from Shop Tetuan, we used to buy these stickers to the
patches.
To these college jackets and go to the school, and everybody was like, what is this, man?
Yeah, it was slightly sweet.
But you wear bells.
Except the heavy metal guys who were
really, it's something else, and they took it to the next level, really.
They
skipped a level, so they went from 3 to the 10 immediately. So
summa summarum, get the fucking album, buy it, or just listen to it on YouTube, but whatever. If you never came across it, you're a dumb fuck, but hey, we are old as fuck also, so I cannot judge people in that sense, but we love it, hope you love it. CNF signing out.
Classic.
Peace.